Good morning, I'm Dan Nagel, discipleship pastor here at the church, and I'm excited about bringing the message this morning. Just want to say thank you very much for the prayers and support that you've given to us over the last weeks and months. My wife sustained an injury in November of 2015, and finally is getting some resolution from a surgery she had in December. So we're grateful for that. She's getting some traction. And then on Christmas Day, I don't know if you know, but our son Ryan, in a skiing accident, fractured C6, C7 vertebrae in his neck. And he's stable and well. He's going to be at home with us for this next semester, but we are grateful for a loving and supporting church family and community in which we live. Well, how about this winter we're having? It's kind of bringing its A game, you know? Coming in like a boss. Winter means business. But what's going on here really doesn't play a candle to what they've got going on over in Portland. Heard things are really bad. Let's take a look.
All right, we want to head up to the east side of Portland for Simon Gutierrez. That's where he is standing by live. He's going to bring us a look at what's happening. You've been in a grocery store parking lot. I see you've moved locations. And there was just a dusting last time we saw you, Simon. But it looks like quite a bit of accumulation now.
Yeah, we're here just a little bit north of Hawthorne, Cesar Chavez. If you look down here, you can see the snow is starting to stick and drift here on the sidewalk. We're seeing some of it on the roadway as well. And that's where these guys come in. This is a Peabot plow truck sort of standing by here getting ready to go if any of the snow does stick to the roadway and accumulate and become a problem. Looks like he's in position to deal with that.
Wow. I did hear that it snowed and it did accumulate. If you look, I think there's stuff floating around now of the bears and elephants and seals frolicking at the Portland Zoo in the welcome snow. Wow. We're in a three-part series of messages on missions. Pastor Jeff last week took us into the world, looking at the global reach of the Christian and Missionary Alliance. Today we're going to look at living a missional life in our local area. Pastor Michael will be wrapping things up next Sunday. When we think of the words missions or missionary, we often think of a person who is leaving the comfort of what they know, the comfort of their language, the comfort of their food, the comfort of their traditions, the comfort of home and family, crossing an ocean, going into another culture to share the love and message of Jesus. My parents, for instance, were missionaries. They were children who grew up separately, went as single people from the United States in the 50s. There was a great wave of missionaries following World War II, and they were part of that. My mom went to Wheaton College, Dad went to Moody. And in those days, there were no commercial airliners, so they had to get on freighters, ships that crossed the Atlantic. They debarked from New York City, went through the Mediterranean Sea, down the Suez Canal, and to the port of Assab, Ethiopia. Since that time, Eritrea has seceded from Ethiopia, and now Ethiopia is a landlocked nation. I don't know how they get their coffee to ports. But my mom and dad left an English-speaking country. They left vehicles and electricity and indoor plumbing. That's how we grew up. We grew up with a wood-burning stove. We didn't have a vehicle. Cross-cultural experience so that people could hear, through my parents, the message of salvation through Jesus Christ. We have a missionary God. He left heaven, came to the earth, left his comforts, left what was probably palatial existence to come live in Galilee, walk the streets of Nazareth, so that we could know his son Jesus, so that we could experience the salvation that he offers through the work of Jesus, his death, burial, and resurrection. God is a missionary God. We hear that through the message of Jesus. Some familiar verses. John 3:16, God so loved the world that he sent his one and only Son, that whoever might believe in him would not perish but have eternal life. At the conclusion of his interaction with a wee little man named Zacchaeus in Jericho, Jesus said, "The Son of Man came to seek and save that which was lost," those who were lost. He was on a mission, a rescue mission. Jesus lived 30 years, began his ministry, and wrapped it up after 3 short years. This is kind of hard to imagine, that he handed the reins over to bumbling, sinful, wretched people like John, Peter, Bartholomew, and he continues to work through us to bring his message to the world. Here are some of Jesus' last statements before he wrapped up his ministry. They are very missional. Matthew 24:14. This is A.B. Simpson, founder of the CMA, one of his favorite verses. "This gospel of the kingdom will be preached to the ends of the earth, and then the end will come." Every nation is going to hear the good news of Jesus before he returns. And Simpson took that to mean that we have a part to play in bringing back the king. So if we do our job and taking that message to every nation, every tribe, every people, once that job is completed, Jesus will come to consummate his kingdom. John 20:21. Again, Jesus said, "Peace be with you. As the Father has sent me, so send I you." So it's somewhat of a relay race. This week, as I was digging into things, I wondered, what is the root of the word missions? Do you know the word mission and missionary is not in the Bible? It's similar to rapture or Easter. The concept surely is embedded there, but the word is apostoleo. It's where we get the term apostle. The Apostle Paul, the Apostle Peter, they were sent by Jesus, and so we are apostles in a sense that we are sent to bring his message to the world. We've been commissioned, as Jesus said in Matthew 28:19-20, "Therefore go and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, and teaching them to obey everything I've commanded you. Surely I'm with you always, even to the end of the age." Known as the Great Commission, these words tell us to bring Jesus' message to all ethnicities, tribes, and people groups. And just as Jesus was about to depart from Jerusalem as he was going to ascend into heaven into the sky, he told his disciples in Acts 1:8, "The Holy Spirit is going to come upon you and everyone who believes, and he's going to give you power to be my witnesses." The word is marturion, where we get martyr. "You're going to be my witnesses in Jerusalem, where you live, the city that we're standing in Judea, the region, the county in which Jerusalem sits, Samaria to the north, and then to the ends of the earth," the uttermost regions of the world. We're part of the CMA, which embraces missions as an endeavor. We're known as the Christian and Missionary Alliance. So missions is in our, it's in our middle name. How many of you knew the CMA prior to coming to Missoula Alliance Church? It's kind of new for you. I think it is for quite a few. The Alliance is a relatively small denomination in the United States, but as Micah brought out, it's over 1 million strong in Vietnam. It's 1 million strong in Cote d'Ivoire in Western Africa. You talk to many missionaries around the world, and they're very familiar with the work of the Alliance. Missions in the CMA. According to Bob Featherland, former vice president of international missions with the Christian and Missionary Alliance, he said, "Our work as a church should be global. We should be global in our reach, but local in our touch." Last week, Pastor Jeff talked about our global outreach. Today, we're going to be talking about local outreach. So in essence, we're going to work Acts chapter 1:8 backwards, in reverse. We're going to go from the uttermost parts to Samaria, to Judea, to Jerusalem. And our Judea and Jerusalem is Missoula, Lolo, Frenchtown, and the surrounding communities. Our primary text this morning, and I'd like you to turn there with me, is in Matthew chapter 9, verses 35 to 38. It's in the Worship Center Bibles, page 964. So either turn in or turn on your Bible. Jesus has been ministering. And it says he went through all the towns and villages. And right now he's in Galilee, which is to the north of Samaria. So he's ministering locally in that region, teaching in their synagogues. Synagogue was a place of worship for Jewish people. They would come together on the Sabbath, read from the prophets, read from the Psalms, read from the Torah, proclaiming the good news of the kingdom and healing every disease and sickness. He was sharing the good news of forgiveness that would come, the healing that would come through him as a person and as Messiah. When he saw the crowds, he had compassion on them. He had a following of people who were trucking along with him, wanting food, wanting to see the next thing he was going to do. He saw the crowds with compassion because they were harassed and helpless like sheep without a shepherd. Then he said to his disciples, "The harvest is plentiful, but the workers are few. Ask the Lord of the harvest to bring workers into his harvest field." Verse 35. He's ministering locally. Every missionary endeavor is a local endeavor. If it's cross-cultural, those people go into that culture, they learn the language, they learn the food, they learn the customs, the things to say, not to say, so that they can minister in that local context. He was going through towns and villages, teaching, proclaiming the good news, healing every disease and sickness. Jesus' ministry began in the town and region where he had grown up, the son of a tecton, a stonemason, carpenter. He was meeting real needs. He was preaching, teaching, yes, but he was meeting real needs of people who were around. And when he saw the crowds, what happened in his heart? What emotion did he feel? Something welled up within his heart, and it was compassion. He had sympathy and empathy for the people who were there before him, because look at the descriptors. They were harassed and helpless like sheep without a shepherd. They were harassed. They lived in occupied territory. Their government was not their own. The Romans occupied their lands. Just imagine living in a town where a Roman soldier could ride through and at his own whim say, "Give me your cheese, give me your wheat. Let me have the things that you've worked hard for," and you have to give it to him. You're harassed by tax collectors who make their living making more than what you should pay. They're harassed by religious leaders who place a heavy yoke of legalism upon them. They're helpless. They're not able to fend for themselves. And with that helplessness comes despair. Poverty of soul. They were sheep without a shepherd. In other words, they didn't have the leadership and care that they should have been receiving. Verse 37, 38. Then he said to his disciples, as a response to his observation of looking around, "The harvest is plentiful, the workers are few." There's an imbalance of the scales here. "Pray and ask that the Lord of the harvest will send workers into the harvest field." What's the harvest? Jesus was a man of parables. He looked around him at his world and he brought spiritual understanding and teaching into everyday life, and he used metaphors. What's the harvest? Well, unfortunately, most of us don't have an agricultural background, but I grew up in Illinois, and harvest is very familiar to those people. There's a harvest of wheat and a harvest of corn and a harvest of hay, and typically you get in a pickup truck and you have combines and trucks with hoppers behind you, and you drive to the field to a specific location and you cut, and the grain falls in and you take it to the harvest store and store it or sell it. The harvest is not a specific location you drive to and you open the gate and therefore reap. The harvest is people. Remember hearing Tim Owen, former district superintendent, say, "The harvest is people who are hurting." There's no shortage of harvest. You are the harvest. Your neighbor next to you in the pew is part of the harvest. People in Missoula are part of the harvest because we hurt. We're helpless. We're harassed. We have needs. Who are the workers? It's not farmers. Got a ConAgra hat on. I drive a Massey Ferguson. The harvesters, the workers, are you and me. It's people who go to meet the needs of hurting people. Jesus' ministry included teaching to large crowds, but much of his ministry was meeting individual needs of individual people. So if you take a look at that text, Matthew 9, 35 to 38, and you look at the surrounding stories, the surrounding paragraphs, you see Jesus having individual contact with individual people. He heals a Roman centurion's servant. Peter's mother-in-law is sick. He heals her so that she can get up and make them dinner. There's a man who's paralyzed. He can't walk. Jesus heals him. Jesus cast out evil spirits from people who had been demon-possessed. Jesus met real needs of real people. He didn't just do missions. He was meeting legitimate needs. Jesus' heart was filled with compassion, and that was his mission, was to begin a revolution of compassion. Compassion was in short supply in Jesus' day. It's in short supply in our day. A revolution of compassion, that's what missionaries do. They go to meet real needs of real people. They provide food. Think about short-term mission trips that you've gone on. What did you do? Missionaries drill wells to give access to clean water. They help rebuild earthquake-ridden buildings in Haiti. Try to help them figure out how to rebuild them so they won't collapse. They teach children to read and write and educate them so that their future looks bright. They go on medical mission trips where they pull teeth and give inoculations. They teach agricultural methods and pull rocks out of fields and teach them how to do terraces so the water doesn't wash away their soil and erode it. They teach them that this is the crop that would work best in your situation. They help people with micro enterprise and business ventures so that they can make their own money. And then, after they've met those needs and gain a fair hearing for the word of God, then they speak the word of truth. They provide the word of truth. God's workers meet physical needs of hurting people. And as we follow the model of Jesus, they also meet spiritual and emotional needs of hurting people. God's workers do that as well. People who are experiencing loneliness, fear, loss, depression, bitterness, hopelessness, despair. That's what comprises working in the harvest, meeting the physical, spiritual, and emotional needs of hurting people. And working in the harvest matches closely to the great commandment. What is the greatest commandment? Jesus said in Matthew, Mark 12, love the Lord your God with all that you've got, your heart, soul, mind, and strength. And the second is like it, love your neighbor as yourself. So missions really is loving your neighbor as yourself. What does it mean to love your neighbor as yourself? I think it means that we stop and consider where other people are. What's going on with them? Are they hurting? Do they have needs? It means showing genuine interest and concern for the well-being of other people. I shared with our PGG. Our PGG is our pastoral growth group. There's other CMA pastors from here in Missoula and Clearwater Junction, Arlie, Ronan, Polson, Hamilton. We get together, and I just shared with them what was going on with our son Ryan. And the last two Saturdays, I open up my email, and Randy Nielsen, who's the pastor at the Alliance Church in Plains, has asked me, how's Ryan? What can I pray for specifically? And last week I asked that he'd sleep. God answered the prayer. Again, this Saturday morning in my inbox and my email, how's Ryan? Anything specific I can pray for? That's love. That's loving your neighbor as yourself. That's being concerned about another person's concerns. I'd like us to look at this, the idea of loving your neighbor in four facets. First is to love your individual neighbor by being someone who is present. Who's my neighbor? It's the person next to you. It's the person in front of you. One of the best ways to really love others is to show genuine interest, to be really interested and listen to people's hearts. Listen intently. Listen with your face. Be someone who's present. Bob Ewell is someone with whom I've consulted. He works for the Navigators, and it's a Christian ministry in Colorado Springs, and I've talked with him about discipleship matters and called him on several different occasions. He said discipleship really is walking alongside people. It's becoming an alongsider, and that's the best way to do that is to be interested in people. And I've got a tool for you, Dan. It's notice, ask, listen, and do. Notice. Take time to really notice the people in your life and decide to be present. Where does your life take you? There are people in your home. Notice them. There are people in your work. When you go to grab coffee, when they walk through the door, notice them. People in your school. If you go to ball games, there's people in the stands. You go to the grocery store, there are people there. They're not just part of the landscape, they're people. Take time to be present and really notice them. And second, when we take time to notice someone, to talk to someone, we ask. And the first ask is to the Holy Spirit. Holy Spirit, you live inside of me. Please help me understand what is really concerning this person right now. What's going on in their RAM, random access memory? What's troubling them? What's on their heart? What are they thinking about? And he's faithful to give an answer to that. And then you ask, how's your shoulder? How's your daughter who went off to college? Been trying to sell a house for a while. How's that going? You've been sick. How's your job going? How's your marriage? God will bring those things to mind and ask. When you ask, listen. Be there. Look in their eyes. Communicate with your body language that you are really listening to that person. And I'll guarantee you that if they pick this up and they know that you're really listening and you care, you'll be there a while. And it's good. So notice, ask, listen, and do. Do what you can. After you've heard what that person has to say, do what you can. Perhaps it's a pat on the shoulder. Perhaps it's a hug. Perhaps it's, hey, can I pray with you? And right there, pray with them. Perhaps their car's stuck in a ditch and you need to help give them a ride. Do what you can. Loving your neighbor individually happens by being someone who is present. Number two, loving your neighbor means loving your neighborhood. So this is, who is my neighbor? This is literally, who is your neighbor? Who lives next door to you? So if you were to draw a map of where you live, and let's just say you live in the middle of the block, there are 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9 houses around you. How many of those people do you know by name? In American society, two inventions in the last 50 or 60 years have taken us away from others, taken us away from our neighbors. You know what they are? Air conditioning. Not so much here in Montana, but air conditioning and a garage door opener. So now we spend time indoors, and we can go in and out of our abode without ever having contact with the living world. Drive in and drive out. You know who In our family, we have one particular member who's really helped us get to know our neighbors. He's four-legged, and he goes by the name Patty. He has a great way of escaping our fence. He knows when the fence has been left open by one of us or one of the friends coming to our house. We haven't been diligent in taking him out for a walk, so he gets out and takes his own bad self for a walk. And we look around and call and look out, oh no, we left the gate open, and I begin to call frantically, have you seen Patty? Let me know if you see him. Fortunately, he's got a little tag on his collar that says Patty, and when you flip it over, you probably have this for your dog, flip it over, got a phone number there. Well, we pray frantically, it's typically how it rolls for an hour or two, and then we get a call from some number we don't know. Hey, we've got your dog, he's really nice, we're home right now. And then we have a chance to meet some more people because they have our dog. In fact, Patty gets around so much that I was out for a walk with a friend going up the sidewalk near Skyview Park, and I walked by this guy I'd never even seen before, and he goes, hey, Patty. Dogs are making their way into sermons here at Mac lately. We as people are very social, but we're not scratching that itch that people have if we just go into our house and don't go out into our neighborhood. Randy Frazee is senior pastor at Oak Hills Fellowship in San Antonio, Texas. You might know his former pastor, Max Lucado, a little better. But Randy, who was a small groups pastor at Willow Creek in Chicago, wrote a book called The Connecting Church. And in that book, he encourages people to spend 15 minutes a day in their front yard. Go shovel, go mow, go water the plants, go repot the plants, wash your car. But spend 15 minutes a day in the front yard and you will get to know your neighbors. We tried it and it works. Two summers ago, there was a forest fire up Sleeman Creek. And that fire was coming up over the top side of the mountain to the place where we could see, up here on Mainview Drive, we could see flames. It's 10:30 at night. We didn't have anything better to do. We grabbed some lawn chairs, put them out on the sidewalk, and sat there and watched the fire. Just like you do. It wasn't so close, and we didn't have any s'mores. 45 minutes later, there were seven other people who had joined us. What are you doing? You're watching the fire. Pretty soon, we get to know our neighbors that live down the street. They just come home from league night at golf and other neighbors over here, and pretty soon, we're having a conversation with our neighbors. People want to be in a relationship with others. Put yourself out there in the front yard. And as you are out there with people, you will see needs that you can meet. We did community cares this last summer, and 15 people went up and helped our neighbors to the north who have disabilities, and our neighbors to the east, one who passed away last spring, he battled diabetes forever. His dear wife is widowed now, and she needed a lot of help with her yard. Thank you, everybody who pitched in to help those real needs. So loving our neighbor starts individually by being present. Loving our neighborhood, we see needs, meet needs. Third, love your community. Do you love Missoula? It's a great place to live, but do you really love the community? I hope we do. How do we love our community? I want to put three things out that we follow these things. First, follow Nehemiah's wall principle. Follow Nehemiah's wall principle. Nehemiah is tucked in there near Esther and Job. It really should be over by Malachi because that's where it fits chronologically. God's people didn't do what they said, what they were supposed to do. They were sent into exile to Assyria, Babylon. And then God gave them a chance to return home to Jerusalem. Nehemiah was a leader, and he took them back. And one of the things that he had to do was rebuild the wall. He was a master planner, a master strategist. He was good at collaboration. And one of the principles that he used was he had people build that section of the wall that was closest to them. Protection from outside enemies is very important, particularly to the part of the wall that you live near, especially if your house is part of that part of the wall. Nehemiah's wall principle is Get involved in the community where you have a vested interest. So if you've got kids that go to a particular school, you're already there, why not help kids with math and reading? And why don't you go there and help out with recess? You know, Robbie trucks over here to, I think he just likes to get out and play. He wants recess himself. But he goes over to Chief Charlo because they don't have enough duties to watch out for the kids during recess. Nehemiah's wall principle. Get involved in the community where you have a vested interest. Maybe it's your neighborhood group, maybe it's your kids, whatever. Follow that principle. Second, follow your interests. What are your interests and hobbies? What do you like to do? What special needs and interests catch your heart? Maybe it's Special Olympics. Maybe it's Big Brother, Big Sister. Maybe it's your hobbies. Go get involved in the community, do that with others, and be a person who's present. Go on a Thursday night ride with a bunch of other mountain bikers and go up the Snake and Blue Mountain and Paddy Canyon, and as you stop and drink your water and eat your Cliff Bar, ask a question or two. You'll find some friends there. Go to the symphony, go to band, go to make quilts, golf, hunt, fish, whatever you like to do, go do that, be present in the lives of others. And third, follow your story. Follow your story. As I was kind of talking through the ideas of this message with my wife, I was kind of landing on, you know, follow your passions. And she said, I think that word's kind of getting overworked. And I would agree. She said, our work as Christians is to figure out how our story intersects with the people that we come in contact with. I agree. Our job as Christians is to do the hard work of figuring out how our story intersects with the people that in whom we come in contact. Trampolines. Trampolines are part of our story. Ever since our boys were five, we bought a trampoline. Went to the emergency room, fixed the trampoline, bounced again, bought another trampoline after that one broke, had to get bigger because our boys were bigger. We've had a lot of trampolines. We know a lot about trampolines. If you have any questions about trampolines, you can ask us. We had a neighbor, last summer, Olympics were on. The marquee event is the 100-meter final, Usain Bolt, right? We're looking forward to the 100-meter final. We're going to have dinner. Kelly's cooking steaks. We're going to have salad. We're all going to sit down and watch this great piece of entertainment. Somebody who can run faster than anybody ever ran before. Just washing my hands at the kitchen, at the sink, getting ready to sit down, and my wife says, Dan, you better get out there and help her. My neighbor, who had just moved in about a month prior, I believe as a single mom, was out there. It's like 6 o'clock at night, and she's starting to put a trampoline together with the help of like three kids. You're right. So I put my stuff down, walked to the fence, looked over. I said, hey, we've put a few trampolines together before. Would you like some help? Oh, would you? Climb the fence, hop over. My name's Dan. My name's Christina. And we're in the thick of building this trampoline. She's got a young boy, and he wants to get on the trampoline. Got to get off of that thing, you know, we're not done yet. We're there for a while. I will say the end of the story is that I got to go in and eat my dinner and watch Usain Bolt win his first of three gold medals. Along the way, young lad, I've forgotten his name, some other friends came to their house, came to the back deck, and they said to him, who are they? And he said, they were our neighbors, but now they're our friends. Trampolines. What's in your story? What do you see around you? Go get involved. Fourth, love your community, not just as an individual, but corporately, as part of a body. Have you ever heard anybody say, I don't like organized religion? I've heard that. I don't trust organized religion. Well, what's wrong with getting organized? You can get together. You can pull your resources, pull your Energy. A great illustration of this is when I was a youth pastor, we annually did the World Vision 30-hour famine. It's where you starve yourself, hang out with middle schoolers for that amount of time. It's a really hard recruit, if you can imagine. I'm not going to eat, and I'm hanging out with 13-year-olds. Anyway, we would break the fast, and one of the first years we did this, I had this great idea of breaking the fast by giving everybody in the group a dollar, and they could go to the grocery store and use that dollar to break the fast. And wouldn't you know that every boy in that group of middle schoolers went individually and they bought a Mountain Dew or a Snickers or chips or something like that, some empty calories that's going to make them even more hungry than they were. But there were groups of girls who pooled their $1 bills, and they came out of the grocery store with a loaf of bread and some lunch meat and a cookies, and they got organized, right? And what happens if we get organized and we pool our resources? We can get some really cool stuff done, like community cares, like foster care, like Mac Garage, like helping out at Grandview Apartments, helping out in our schools. You know, it's so neat to tell people about some of these endeavors. For instance, with foster care, I was talking with somebody who's involved with foster care in another entity, and he said, you know, that foster care, that dinner you guys have, that's just the best thing. That's what we're doing in Billings. That's what we're doing in Great Falls. That's what we're doing in Kalispell. That monthly dinner where those people can come together, they can talk with other people, they can get support, the kids can go play in the gym. And then that closet that's here, foster care family gets a call at 2 in the afternoon saying, you got a 6-month-old, a 3-year-old, and a 6-year-old that are going to be on your doorstep in 3 hours. Laura, help! And they can come here and they can get diapers and formula and a crib and a stroller and car seats and everything, boots and coats, to get those kids up and running. Thank you, Mac. Thank you, God, for a little bit of organization as we get together. Well, as we start to descend and the wheels come out and bring this thing in for a landing, our work as Christians is to figure out how our story connects with the stories of those with whom we come in contact. Our story recently is my son broke his neck. And wouldn't you know that we have a lady in our life who's touched by that. She happens to be somebody that my wife supervises through Puritan Cleaners. And she's lost her own son, and she lost his son-in-law. We did his memorial service here last November, Bill Hamilton. And she just wants to feed us. So I go there, and she doesn't have much. She probably lives in one of the cheapest apartments she could live in Missoula. And I'm driving there every other night to pick up dinner. And we joke about, you know, we've got to quit meeting like this. People are going to start to talk. And she says, how's Ryan? And it was coming to the point where we're realizing he wasn't going to go back to school. And I'm thinking about all these calls we have to make about scholarships and financial aid and deferments and all of this. And she just looks right at me. She says, he's alive. Yes, he is. So I've changed my tune, thanks to Carol. You know, sometimes the workers become the harvest, right? And now when people ask me, one of the first things I say is, he's alive, and he's moving, and he's going to be well. Our stories intersect with so many people if we allow God to use us or let others serve us and help us. Pete and Diane Joy are a great part of our church family, and is at their home, and they got a thing by their front door. If we pull up that picture, it's a something, just a memorable sign. I don't know if you can make it out, but it says, believe there's good in the world, and the yellow says, be the good. Amen? Let's pray. Dear God, I just amazed that you would consider us the next people who would carry on the message, the next people who would carry out the vision of reaching our world. You've entrusted the kingdom to such as us. Thank you for that. Help us to be faithful in that. And as we look around, we recognize that many people are harassed and helpless, and sheep without a shepherd. I just want to pray for them today. I just want to pray for anyone who's feeling harassed right now. Harassed by a spouse, harassed by a landlord, harassed by an employer, harassed by a neighbor. Harassed by whatever situation, if they're just feeling abused. I just pray that you'd meet them in that. You care. You have compassion for that, God. For anyone who feels helpless this morning, there's no way they can pay all the bills that they have. There's no way that retirement looks like a good thing because they can't figure out how they're going to afford it. For people who are looking at their own health and wondering how they're going to make it, their own relationships are feeling helpless. I just pray, Lord, that you would give them hope, that the good news of the gospel would sink down into their hearts, that you make sense of life, that you are able to bring good out of seemingly hard situations, that you're able to redeem. I pray for those in the room who feel like sheep without a shepherd. I just pray that you would give them good leadership, you would care for them, that you would heal them, that you would let them know that you know their name. Pray that they'd hear your voice and follow you. Thank you, Jesus, that you are a good shepherd, and thank you that you've allowed us to be part, even though we're part of the harvest, you've allowed us to be workers as well, and I pray that you would compel us to be those workers that you are asking us to pray for. In Jesus' name, amen.